All right, and welcome everyone. Welcome to Five Takeaways to Bust Through Today's Selling Barriers. Wow, am I excited? And the reason being is that when I graduated from college in 1986 and started in advertising of all fields, I was flooded with information and books about Steve Schiffman, who is going to be our presenter today. And let me tell you about Steve, what makes Steve so unique and why he's here today. He's author of 70 best-selling books. Many of these have been revised in the classic cold calling techniques. He's worked in more than 43 countries, trained over 9,000 professionals. This man is a legend. He's been a guest on national radio and television, Jim Bohannon Show, CBNC. He's been on Smart Money. I mean, the list just goes on. He's worked with more than 212 Fortune 500 companies, and of course, many small and medium-sized companies in every industry that you can imagine. Steve, if it wasn't for you, I wouldn't be where I am.
I know. That's a problem. I know. That is the problem. We're both together and we're still here all these years later.
Yes, we are. We saw. So thank you. Okay. Thank you for joining. We're going to be learning. We want to hear from you because the depth and breadth of what you bring to the table, you've been through so many ups and downs and you've witnessed it. People are going to get some incredible takeaways. So let us begin. Let's start. Let's start with that number one. Tell us about what is the mindset and what that means moving forward.
You know, one of the things that I see with salespeople, and that's what we're talking about, is you hit a rut. And I'm explaining what I mean by that. I don't even like the word rut. I use it every time. What happens is in your career, if you've been selling for 5, 10, 15, 20 years, all of a sudden it hits you that maybe you're not going to get the promotion you want. You're not going to make the $1.5 million. And so you sit there and you say to yourself, what do I do? The answer to that question is you have to reinvent yourself. But people don't know what that means. So they end up either mentally checking out, physically stopping, literally they could quit, or just kind of coasting along. And the end result is they're the same as they were 5 years ago and 10 years ago, and then they retire and that's what it is.
Yes.
The suggestion here is knowing how to reinvent yourself, to change. Now, I don't mean wearing a funny little hat. That's not what I'm talking about. But what I am talking about is, when was the last time that a salesperson, you, I'm talking to the group, really looked at yourself and said, you know, maybe I should do things differently. Maybe I should find a different way. Maybe I should ask different types of questions. And then it raises the issue, which I think is a big issue and we should really talk about for a minute, is how do you, who is selling a commodity, because everybody is, there's a billion guys like you and me, everybody's a commodity, it's price driven. How do we separate ourselves out from everyone else? What can we say, what can we do that makes us different?
So can you give us an example? What that might look
yes,
like,
because
I'm with
absolutely.
You on it, I've been
Oh, absolutely.
There.
Here's the biggest problem. You go back a number of years, and I hate to mention 1950, 1960, and you realize that was needs-driven sales. Mm-hmm. Then we went into another phase of finding solutions. Well, I got to find a solution. That'd be a problem. And you and I know that routine where you go in and say, Mr. Prospect, you have a problem. You just don't know what it is. Well, the fact of the matter is the person says, I don't have a problem. I'm okay. And you say, well, no, let me chip away. I'll find it. Nah, all wrong. The reality of sales today is finding out what people do, how they do it, when they do it, where they do it, who they're doing with, if they're doing something, and then helping them do it better. Key to selling is helping people do what they do better. If you can help someone do what they do better, you're going to make a sale. If all you're doing is filling the
same. I love where you're going because you're making me think to say, well, if I'm in that complacent sort of go through mindset, maybe our customers are going through a similar way, and we need to get out of our own comfort zone and challenge the comfort, because our customers need us more than ever is what I'm hearing.
No question about it. Look, the fact is, let's take a absolutely dumb example. You sell paper. That's to make something normal. You sell paper.
Okay.
The reason you see that particular prospect is because they buy paper. That's why you go there. Okay. So they have paper already. You know they have paper.
Right.
But no one ever says, how come you're not buying my paper? They don't say that. They go, let me tell you how better my paper is. Well, that's irrelevant. It's got to be relevant for them for it to be better. And if it's not relevant to them, it doesn't matter what you're talking about. And that's the biggest issue that you see in sales today.
Relevancy. So we got to take the time to listen and understand and identify the issues of our customers. Is that correct?
What you want to do is help them do what they do better, which means you have to understand what is their business. What do they do? How did they get, for example, I'll give you a simple example. And I get 20% increase in sales when I train this. If you will simply, as a salesperson, go into somebody and say, listen, Mr. Prospect, I'm just curious. You're not buying from us. Is there a reason? And just stop talking. Just stop talking.
Good.
And then you hear the story behind it. And that tells you the information you need.
It's that's a good question is a truth-seeking missile. Let's get to the truth. I love it. So you do. We get to challenge our customers. Good. We find out, is there a need or not? Qualify. All right. I love this about mindset. Getting out of our own rut and helping to – we got to move beyond product selling, pitching, right?
To really take
time to connecting more with our customers. Is that what I'm hearing?
I had a client. I'll just give you an example. I had a client and we were selling to supermarkets. They sell supermarket chains. And I went with them to shadow. And I watched the young woman. It was interesting because all she did was line up her product and say, are you interested? Well,
yeah,
I guess maybe one day, 100 years from now. But that's not selling. That's maybe demonstrating. Yeah. I'm not even sure it's anything, really.
Some people call that solution selling. I think, good. All right, let's get into number two. Let's talk about, you mentioned strengths, okay? Can you expand on what we mean by strengths?
Yeah, sure, of course. You know, everybody has strengths and weaknesses, and I hate that. That's the cliche.
A lot of weaknesses.
Oh, yeah, you know that. I mean, it's the cliche. It's the cliche. What are your strengths? What are your weaknesses? However, what we fail to realize is that there are opportunities for us to communicate with prospects, especially this time of year, this whole period right now, that we can communicate with our prospects, with our customers in different ways. It isn't just lifting the same barbell over and over again.
For example, most people
don't use the mail. They don't use the mail. No one uses the mail. We use the internet, email. But, you know, the mail worked 20 years ago, and it will still work if people open the envelope. So what happens is we don't use the things that we really do know will work. The strength meaning in this category, the strength is really saying to yourself, what is it that I can do that maybe I haven't done in a long time? Now, I'll give you an example. I have a person, I coach a lot of people. And I said to the person I was dealing with the other day, actually yesterday, and I said to him, listen, I want you to call up every single person that you deal with, your clients. And I want you to say this, hello, is there anything I can do for you at all? Nothing to do with sales, don't mention sales. Just say, anything I can do for you? Can I help you? Is there something you need? Just say that. Then end the conversation if you get through. If not, leave it as a voicemail. 44% of the people that he called, 44% called him back and said, hey, thanks for the call. I really appreciate it. Can't do anything right now, but hey, I appreciate it. He got in touch with everybody. That's an incredible ratio. That's an incredible
ratio. Like that. Awesome. So I think people can learn from that takeaway. We need to call up, get a hold of people, and what's that question we need to ask?
Simply say, is there anything I can do to help you? Don't ask about sales. Don't talk sales. Don't go. Just say anything. I did it myself. I wrote emails to my favorite people, but my good clients. And I simply said, hey, listen, you okay? That's all I said. You okay? They wrote back. They wrote letters. They wrote emails. They told me their whole history. Because you know what? They want to tell you.
Good. They do. They want to vent. They want to talk. I thank you for that. I want to get back to that. I love what you said about the mail, for example. I mean, I look at the mail coming in. It's got to be down almost 50%. Wow. Why don't we get a stamp and a letter? You know what? That works. Direct mail still works. Let's still try works. Other avenues. Let's get still recreative.
Works. Still works. You know, it's funny. Thank you. Think about it. When you go get your mail, you go through it real fast. Everybody does. Bop, 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 right? The bills you put to the side, but the yes. ones that are birthday cards, the holiday cards, you open right away.
Yes, you do.
Anything personal, you open.
Good. So if we want to get attention, let's try it. I love that. So, okay, it's leveraging our strengths. And I love this too, is that part of that strength is we have relationships out there. This is a time that I'm hearing part of leveraging strengths is let's make those relationships more meaningful. And I love your approach. Is there anything that I can do? It's putting the sales part aside, but connecting with people at a more deeper, meaningful level. Beautiful.
Yes. I'll tell you just a quick story. This is years ago. You know, I've been doing this so long, but years ago, I had a sales manager, and he was selling products, and I was dealing with this particular customer, and he said a particular company, and he said to me, "Let's hug." And I what? Now, of course, today you can't do it. He said, "Let's hug." And I did. And I got to tell you, it firmed up the relationship. Now, I'm not saying do that, but I'm saying it's very funny what people will do and how they make things personal. Because after all, isn't sales personal?
Yeah.
You're doing something very personal. And the other thing, which I just want to mention here, don't be confused who the buyer is. The fact that you're dealing with one person, you're forgetting that there are usually 12 others that circulate around that particular buyer. I call it the power of 12, that actually will help make that decision. It's not just one person. Rarely does one person say, "I'll buy it."
Yeah. You know, and I'm glad you said that. I was interviewing Jim Lassengame of the Small Business Show yesterday. And like you, he has a depth and breadth of experience. And he said, let's not forget, eventually we got to get back to face-to-face selling and shaking the hand. So I hear it about the hug, shaking the hand. There's going to be day we're going to return to that. The sooner the better. Yes. Yeah. So leveraging strength. Thank you for that. Let's go on. Let's talk about the next area to bust through the selling barriers. You mentioned gaining traction. We're all anxious to hear that because being in that rut, being in this paralysis, not sure what to do, we need to get out of this rut, this hole. How would you like to expand on this?
Yeah, okay. What's going to happen, and you and I both know this, is as time progresses, and it's terrible, this is, look, let's be realistic. This is not a happy time for most people in the country. I'm sure everybody has realized that they've lost somebody they know or related to. I mean, it's a whole situation. So let's be realistic about this.
Okay.
However, at the same time, we're going to have to do something to get people involved with us again. Here's what's going to happen. When this is over, which it will be, when it's over, people are going to need product. And they're going to think about you if you are the existing seller. If you are, in fact, still here, still working with them, still helping them all this time, they're going to think of you. If not, they're going to go someplace else. They're going to find the fastest demand, that is the fastest shipper that they can get the product they need. Then it'll be a need-driven sales. You will have difficulty taking new business because people are not going to change right away. They're going to go back to the habits. So therefore, you need to do things now to gain traction with new prospects. Whether you're calling, whether you're emailing, whether you're sending the letter, it doesn't matter to me. You've got to do something to make sure that they recognize you as a viable producer or seller of products that they need, that they use right now. There'll be a time when they will shift over to new suppliers. Not going to happen right away. Not going to happen. They're going to go back to who they know. So you're going to get your existing business by default. Listen again. You'll get your existing business by default. But there'll be somebody trying to get the new business because they need that too to survive.
Yeah. You know, thank you for sharing that. I see this even in good times. For example, I work in all industries. One industry in particular is interesting is the agricultural industry.
Yes.
And not limited to this, but there's a mindset where when things are quiet and slow, it's sort of like, okay, let's take it easy. I'll go hunting, fishing. And when things pick up, kind of like wait for the phone to ring. And I'm like, no, the time to get the business is when you're planning and strategizing. So when that phone is ringing, it's ringing for your needs. And I just had a situation like you coaching a salesperson this week. And it was doom and gloom in the beginning. It's like, you know, all these projects have stopped. Nobody's buying. And I'm like, okay, well, let's just make calls and let's see what happens. Interesting, you know, as we started making these calls, well, I haven't talked to this guy in a year. Well, I did leave a voicemail and it was like six. I'm like, okay, well, obviously it tells me there's a lot of opportunities to call out there. Here's where I'm going with this. This individual ended up making, it was crazy, made 15 calls and ended up getting 4 good promising opportunities. Mm-hmm. I'm not saying it's going to be that easy, but it's amazing by gaining traction, we got to get proactive. Isn't that correct?
Yeah.
All right. It's like gaining traction. I love where you're going with that. Let's move on to that next one. Rev it up. Woo-hoo.
Okay. Let me just talk about something here that kind of is a quirky thing that I believe in. When I talk about revving it up, when I talk about making something happen, you've got to be realistic. I think a lot of salespeople are not realistic about what a prospect is. A prospect to me is somebody who's playing ball with me. That is, we're communicating, it's back and forth, they return the call, they return the message, we're back and forth. So many people today have things in their list of prospects that don't have a chance of happening, that the person's not interested, they're not calling back, it may happen 6 years from now, but you can't count that as a prospect. The most important thing to me is being realistic about your pipeline. What does your pipeline tell you about your business? It's going to be the predictor and indicator of what the future has for you. So if I was to use this little shot here with the rocket going up, I would say to you it's the same thing, that if you do not have a solid pipeline that accurately reflects what your business is going to be, which may be nothing. I mean, let's get real. It may be nothing. But at least you know where you start to build.
Yeah.
Most people, when I talk to them, I say, well, what do you have? Oh, I got 150 things going. No, you don't. You can't. You can't, unless you're selling on a street corner. You can't have 150 things going. Most salespeople, average salesperson that I talk to, has maybe 15 things that of those, they're not all going to close.
Right.
They say, oh, well, all of them close. No, they're not going to close.
Thank you.
You got to know your ratio.
We get a lot.
What the number is.
So let's be realistic too, okay?
Yes, very important.
I appreciate you sharing this with me. I was on a coaching call with a rep and, you know, again, it was how to qualify that pipeline.
Yes.
And, you know, you have certain customers out there saying, I don't know what I'm going to do. It's so bad out there. I'm just going to wait and see. And others are thinking more proactive. And I said, we got to qualify. And I said, here's what you want you to do. Your question is as follows. We're going to get out of this mess. So let me ask you, what are your plans moving forward? Mm-hmm. Now, we sat on calls just using that approach. And it was interesting because it really split the pool into two. Those that didn't have a clue and those that really had some initiative, mindset, strategizing. And my recommendation, based on what you're saying on that pipeline, is that when we do get out of this mess, where to invest your time, energy, and resources wisely to push that through your funnel.
Let's just say here for a second, because there are two things that I think we miss.
Yep.
In sales, there are two significant pieces. Number one are the steps. And I don't care what you want to call them. There are steps in the process.
Take us through them. This is important.
Okay. Well, the way I look at it, very simple. The objective of the first step is to get to the second step. That's all it is.
Okay.
Objective of the second step is to get
third step. Give us an example.
Sure. A simple example. I meet with somebody. We have a great conversation. Wonderful. Wonderful guy.
Exactly. Right? Oh, man.
And then I say, and here's the end. I say, you know what, Bill, Paul, Joan, why don't we get together next week? and discuss it. Okay. And they go, call me in 6 years. That is nothing. That's nothing. Nothing. Yeah, right. I have reps that actually put that down as a 50-50 chance of closing. I had somebody when I was in my other business who called me up and he said to me, real estate broker, and he said, listen, he said, do you need real estate right now? We had just signed a 10-year lease. True story. We signed a 10-year lease. So mm-hmm. I said, listen, honestly, true story. I said, honestly, I just signed, which I did. I just signed a 10-year lease. He said, oh, okay. Do you mind if I call you then? 10 years? I said, yeah, if I'm alive and you're alive, call me. I don't care at that point. But the point is, there are two things. One is you've got to get to the next step, which is the next appointment or the next meeting or the next, what I call recommendation. I don't even call it proposal anymore. You've got to get to the next step. But the second thing is time. There is the longer a sale takes out of its normal sales cycle, the less likely it is to happen. Listen to it again. The longer a sale takes out of its normal, whatever that is, sales cycle, the less likely it is to happen.
That's very true.
So if you're sitting there waiting for somebody, 16 years later, it's gone. It was gone 15 years ago.
It would be like my sales cycle. I find it's going to be 5 to 6 months. If it goes 8 or 9 months, goes way down the opportunity.
That's right. That's right. And it does with everybody. It's not that everybody has a definitive sales cycle, but most people don't understand it. They go in. For example, the simplest thing is to understand when the person's going to run out of product. That could be your sales cycle. But if you don't ask that question and you don't know, I remember I had somebody that I was working with and he said to me, well, they're running out of their product in 3 weeks. I said, good. Did you get an order? He said, well, I didn't ask.
Right. There you go.
You knew they were going to run out.
Steve, I appreciate this. You know, obviously we've all seen the movie or heard of it, Glengarry Glenn Ross. Yes. And you remember the old selling techniques, always be closing, ABC. I used to gag and cringe at that concept. I was taught that in the 80s.
Right.
But you know what? I embrace it now because each and every step, what I'm hearing is we should
close on that step.
Next step.
Oh. Close on that step. Just get to the next meeting. It's all you do. And there's a way to do it, which is very unthreatening.
Good. Hey, Steve, we got a question, okay, that comes in because it really ties in with what you're bringing up now. And that is, how do I motivate my sales team to really keep their pipeline accurate and make them believe they can actually use it as a very useful tool? They can use it to increase their sales. And they currently see this as a lot of work.
Yeah. You know, Paul, it's interesting. In the number of years I've been doing this, the same questions are raised. There are no new questions. I hate to tell you, but there are no new questions. No new questions. You remember Tom Peters?
Sure.
Okay. Sure. I don't think most of our audience will remember.
Just mention who he is just so they
Tom
know.
Tom Peters was a consultant who wrote a very successful book and with somebody else. And he went to major companies and he investigated what made them successful, HP, et cetera.
Yes.
But the point is, he talked about managing by walking around. And what a manager should do, to be absolutely honest, and this is what I did, you just keep walking around. You don't sit down. You walk around. How's it going? How's it going? What's going on? And you're involved, and that motivates. You see, if you're not involved, if you don't really know what they have, then you can't correct it. You can't help. But if you start to listen, I had in my office, I had on every salesperson's desk two phones. One was the phone they were using, obviously, but the other was a handheld piece that I could listen to the call. So I knew and I could direct and I could coach what they were saying. So we did it together. We were involved together in everything that we did. And I had 20 salespeople. I had 12 trainers. We were involved together in everything. That's the only way you get to do it. You can't go whip them. That's not going to happen.
Thank you.
You're going to threaten them.
That's not being involved. No, thank you for that. Because it's part of, you know, we can always enhance our communication. How do we do that virtually? Okay. You know, what are some ways to keep that bonding, that connection, if we can't walk around? Suggestions?
Well, it's easy. Why don't you just have a call and here's your question. What's your next step on that call? And what's your next step on this? And more important, what have you started today? See, nobody asked that question.
I love it.
Nobody asked the question. What did you start?
Good.
What's new? What did you bring in? Start. Just start, not close. Forget close. Close you can predict. Start you can't if they don't participate with it.
That's
so
right.
So you have to know close.
Thank you.
Got it. I don't care about close. I got it. But the starts, I need that. Nothing here, nothing there.
That's like a parent teaching their kids. Why did you do that? What are you, stupid or something? You know what I mean? When we're condescending and critical, I like that. Let's initiate and be proactive. That's collaborating. Yeah. Right. Thank you for that. That's a good. Hey, we got another question that came in here. What do we have? Because it goes back to this about, is there anything I can do? The question came up is, what happens after you've called all your customers and you ask the question, is there anything I can do for you? Then what do you do? That's real, man. We're like running out of opportunities now. Suggestions.
Well, let's be honest. Are you really? I mean, I hear salespeople say to me, I called everybody. Come on, get real. You didn't call everybody. You know it. I know you didn't. And if you did, you didn't reach through. You didn't get through to everybody.
Yeah.
There's plenty of people. Go get some, call some new people. Call some new people that are not your clients. And say, listen, I was thinking about you. See the opening question. I was thinking about you.
Yes.
Is there anything I can do to help you? Just say that. Because nobody says that. Nobody reaches down and says, I'll help you up. Just say that to people.
That's right.
And there's, you know what I'm talking about.
I don't need any help. I'm okay. Everything's good. And the reality is deep down, you know, at least 50% of people feel vulnerable, insecure, and just, you know, in fear.
Yeah. I think we're overthinking the reaction that people are going to have.
Thank you. Good. Good. I love it. Let's get into people, people, people. Because that was the fifth area that you want to explore. And why is that important?
Okay, because people are your company. People are what happens. You sell to people. You do not sell to a company. You just don't sell to a company. You think you might. Oh, I'm dealing with this company, big company. No, it's a person. It's a man.
It's like the board of the committee. Yeah, same thing.
Yeah, I mean, a committee. Well, committees are very funny. My favorite thing about committees, and you've done this, you know what it's like. You go into a committee and there's always some court jester in the committee. You know, you go, oh, please.
That's
but
right.
The fact, you know what I'm talking about. But the fact of the matter is, you want to make sure that you're personalizing your sale, that you're discussing real stuff that really matters to people.
That's right.
You know, it matters to her differently than to him, than differently to her, differently to him. You've got to think about that. You've got to understand. Now, here's something that's important. If you're selling to a group, which you are inevitably it'll be a group. Why that group? How did those people assemble? Who brought them? What's their role? Most people don't ask that question. They go into a group and they go, oh, there's 12 people here. I'll do the same presentation. No, you've got to know the individuals. It's just like you and I, when we train, you know the people you're training. You know how she feels or he feels, what's going on in the audience.
Yeah.
Are they...
You know, Steve, when you mentioned this.
Using the phone, nonverbal is very important. Here's what happens. Let's take the first guy all the way over the green shirt. Let's say we say to him, Bill, I want you to do this for me. But then we go, you don't have to. See, we do that nonverbally. We actually communicate nonverbally. 65% of the way we communicate is nonverbal. Yeah. So what we're doing is we're not saying to Bill, do it. We're saying to Bill, you know, if you get to it, do it, but don't really have to do it. You, to the woman, you got to do it. See, so we're not even giving clear messages many times. So
when we talk about the people, it really is about, you know, people, companies don't make decisions, people do. And I even like to take it further. I like to identify that one or two players in that group who's an influencer, who's a champion, who's really passionate. How do I leverage to gain further insight into the organizational and political dynamics? It's like you said, if I'm going to go and give a presentation to the quote unquote board or committee, I'm doing a lot of homework, reaching out to people individually before I even get in front of the people. Because
can I give you a caution?
Say that?
Can I give you a caution?
Oh, please. One yes.
I want to give you a caution.
Please.
I get this all the time from salespeople now. Never got it before, but now you get it. I'm going to check it out on Google.
Yeah.
I'm going to go on Google and research the company.
Yeah,
I'm
right.
Figure out who the decision makers are on Google.
Oh.
Right. So what happens is people go on Google, three hours there, going down the rabbit hole someplace.
Yes.
They finally hit something else down there that has no relation to anything. And they come back up and they think they know. You don't. You cannot assume that Google is going to give you the information.
Thank you.
I think it's ludicrous to say to yourself, well, I know who the president of the company is and what his buttons are because I start on Google or LinkedIn or whatever it is. It doesn't work that way. It just doesn't.
But it's still planning 101. I still surprised how many salespeople don't do that.
I agree with you. No.
Planning 101, that. But pick up the phone and say, hey, give me the inside scoop. Really help me understand what's really going on in the organization. Having that conversation is just so powerful. And it's funny how you say spending 3 hours on Google when I can find that out and all that in 5 minutes.
That's right.
People.
That's exactly right. Exactly good. Right. You don't need, 3 hours, come on, give me a break. And I hear it all the time. I hear that all the time.
Okay. Well, here's what I'm hearing two things about people, because I know we could spend a day on this, but two things for those in a sales leadership capacity, what can we do? This is our internal customers now. So what can we do to inspire, keep them motivated, keep them focused? Because the real world is the things you've introduced, being in ruts, you may get us out of inspired us for a day or two, but it's easy to sink back into the rut.
Yeah.
Help us from a sales leadership standpoint.
Okay. So first of all, let's accept that money is not the motivator.
Okay. All right.
Everybody goes, oh, it's money. It isn't money. First of all, and they'll say this. I mean, I get this. They'll say to me, look, the person, the woman, the man, they got kids in college and they got to afford that and blah, blah. Yeah. But they knew about that before you. So it isn't like a surprise to them. It isn't like anything's a surprise. They're going to buy a house. Hey, they knew it. So they thought that through. So you're not going to go in there and say, hey, you want to buy that house? I can pay you more. That's not going to happen. So you're going to be realistic about their lifestyle. Remember we talked about that you hit a certain plateau, a certain point,
right,
where you're content with where you are,
yes,
or you drop out. Well, that happens. That happens to all of us. There isn't anybody who's participating today that hasn't had that moment where they go, oh, I think I'll just kind of stop. Because we all go through that.
Right.
And eventually everybody does.
They don't say it, but it's that thinking thought. Right.
So,
I agree.
So to motivate, now motivation is a very funny thing. You've got to understand the person that you're dealing with. And the problem is the person doesn't always tell you that.
That's right.
So you're sitting there going this one-on-one meeting saying, oh, you know, Cheryl, if you did this. But they don't care about it because they're not looking for that increase in income. Because that's not the thing that motivates
them. Thank you.
What might motivate them is more time off. What might motivate them is being President's Club. What might motivate them, which I find, is recognition among their peers. So you can't say to somebody, I'll give you $10 more. That's not going to do it.
You know, I love this because it's that question you went back to earlier, though. Is there anything, and I want to reach out to my people. What is it? What is it I can do for you? And we've got to be asking that question to our internal people. We may not always get the answer, but I want us to be digging because I want to understand what are the motivations where I can collaborate because we're going to get out of this together. And you know what's going to happen? That strength, you know, you talk about the external customer, the relationship will be strong. I want to make those internal relationships strong. Man, this is one. I wish we had.
Let me give you something.
Really get into this stuff even further.
A thought.
You know, here, I want to ask you something. It came in. There's another question that came in.
Okay.
And that is, how do I get out? And the question is, how do I get out of doing the same things without getting bored? Which I'm thinking, the reality is, there are some salespeople feeling a little bored and unchallenged, which is blowing me away, thinking, how can you be bored? But give us some ideas to overcome this, because this is real world.
Okay. All right, so let me go back to college. So we go way back. All right, I was in college, and I'm sitting in a class. To this day, I never forgot it. I'm sitting in a class, and upstate New York, and the professor calls me, and she points me. She says, Matt, what do you think the answer is? I said, Matt, who the hell's Matt? And Matt was my roommate, but she thought I was Matt. So, Matt, what do you think? And I'm sitting there going, Matt, who's Matt? I didn't even, it's my roommate. So I said, she's confusing me with him because we kind of look alike. I don't know. Right. But from that moment, I wore a tie and a shirt and a suit virtually every day in college. The rest of my career. I said, I'm not going to be recognized as Matt ever again. And I wasn't. people don't see that. They don't see that they fall into the same stuff. You go through somebody's closet, you see the same clothes, see the same type of clothes. Change it. Do something different.
Thank you.
The problem is, the problem is this, and here's the problem. The problem is this right here. Now, you can see what this is.
A turtle, yes.
So why do I have a turtle on my desk?
Yes.
I have a number of them here. People send them to me. The reason is that a turtle, right here, turtle, doesn't get ahead unless it stick its neck out.
Yeah, thank you.
And most people don't stick their neck
out. Thank you. Oh, that's wonderful. Thank you. I can relate to that. Good. We got one more question that came in, and that is, how do I decide if this is a good time now to get into selling?
Well, it's a difficult time, but it's not any more difficult than anything else. Sales is a job. It is a job. It's a great job. It's a great career if that's what you want to do. But you got to think about it. You got to think, what is it that you have to learn? See, people don't learn. They fall into sales. That's and then right. A manager says you do it this way, and a manager tells you to do it this way, and somebody else tells you to do it this way, and you read a book, and you do some. Most people, by the way, 90% of all salespeople fail to read a sales book.
Yeah.
90% fail to read a sales book.
And you know, Barnes & Noble did a study of people who buy books, sales books, or any book out there, business book. 9 out of 10 never open up to even read
it. Right. Oh, they don't. They buy my books, but I know they're not read because they'll say, I didn't really open it. Good. But the point, I want to make something else. Yeah. I just want to make something else about motivation because I kind of passed on that, and I want to make sure I go back to that.
Good.
When I hire somebody from my company, I interview the person and their significant other. Now, why do I do that? Because what I know is that's where the support base is going to come from.
Yeah.
The significant other is going to be the person that's going to be behind the person.
Yes.
To say, you can do this or you should not do this.
Yes.
Most people don't do it. When I suggest that to managers, they go, do what? Take the significant other, go to lunch together, the three of you, four, whatever it is. Sit down and talk about what their goals are. Because you cannot accomplish your goal if your significant other is opposed to it. It won't happen. Oh,
I love it.
Will not happen.
You know, it gets back to whether it's external customers or internal customers. Let's make our relationship dig deeper, broader, and higher. Why wouldn't we want to know who the significant others, their values, beliefs, wants, and needs, where they can support, where the challenges are? Hey, we got a question.
Go further.
Yeah.
When somebody gets a job, a new job, who do they tell? Just think about it. Then you realize mother, father, brother, sister, wife, husband, however, so they're going to go there. That's who they tell.
Yeah.
And if you're not involved in that, so for example, you asked me about how do you motivate? What we used to do when somebody did a good job, we would send a gift to the house.
Yeah.
Didn't have to be a big deal to the house. Now, why to the house? Well, first of all, other person opened it. It came, it arrived. The kids, if there were kids, saw the gift. It was on the mantle or was on the table.
Yeah.
It became something where everybody said that was sent to him or her for recognition. So it became this multi-level recognition, not just one person.
All right. Here's what I'm hearing too, though, when it comes to motivating our people, whether it just comes to the hiring, let's continue to give recognition, appreciation, making people feel important, valued, especially now. Is going to be key to driving performance. But really, let's do it in not in a manipulative or exploitive way, but really because genuinely we do care about our people. That's what
we have to. We do.
Yeah, we got a question on motivation here that came in, and that is, how do I motivate new prospects, people I've never met yet, when I can't even meet these people face to face? Steve, you're the author of cold calling.
All right. So realistically, there are a couple of things you got to do. First of all, you got to go back to the basics. You got to cold call. You got to call people. And if you're not going to call, if you simply think, well, sending email is going to do it, it's not. So you're going to have to pick up the phone. Somewhere in that cycle, you're going to have to pick up the phone. Somewhere in that cycle, you're going to have a face-to-face meeting.
Yeah.
If you can't get the face-to-face meeting, the odds are you're not going to get the sale. So lesson one. Learn how to make a telephone call. a telephone call is not as significant as people think. In other words, I'll explain what I mean by that. When you call someone up, it's not what you say that matters. It's what they say that matters. How to handle the objection or the response.
Yes.
If you do not, and by the way, the response is, well, I could understand that, but other, no, there's a way to handle it that derails the conversation so that you have a chance to explain what you're talking about.
Yeah.
If you don't know how to do it, if you haven't practiced that skill, if you haven't learned that skill, you know what? You're probably not going to be able to do it.
Steve, I'm glad you said that because I do work with a lot of salespeople and I see that there's, you know, their comfort zones. Some are incredibly skilled and very confident face-to-face. And then when you get them on the phone to make calls, they shrivel up like a prune. Here's what happened. What we witnessed one company where the salespeople were struggling with those that just were not comfortable using the phone. They had no choice but had to pick up the phone. After doing this for 2 weeks, we had two of the individuals come back and say, I can't believe this, how effective making calls are, because they were forced to make 40, 50 dials a day to connect with people. And they were like, I can talk to so many more people that I couldn't face to face. And it really became a revelation. These were seasoned people. It wasn't easy, but it changed their paradigms. And there's a lot we can do. I'm not trying to say it's going to take the place of face to face, but we need to be more flexible and adaptable. This environment's challenged us to have to do that.
Well, the other issue is going to be the virtual call, where we're going to use Zoom and other services like this in order to have conversations with people. It's going to be a challenge. That's a challenge because people will, they'll put it down. They'll say, yeah, you can call me on such a date. And they're not there.
Steve, we got another question. Another question. Should I still have a goal to get new business even during the COVID-19 dilemma? Thoughts on that?
No, just think of failure. Just say to yourself, I'm going to fail. That's it. Just do that.
No. I love
this.
And
you know what?
Why?
And then you'll fail. Okay. Then you don't have to worry about it. If you don't want a goal, if you say, hey, no goals, I can't accomplish anything, you're probably right.
Yes.
See, too blunt, right? You're probably right. If you want to fail, go ahead.
You'll do
it. It's easy to fail. It's easier to fail than succeed. Go ahead and do it.
You know, I'm glad you said that.
Failure.
Cold calling, prospecting is all about getting no's and failures. And you know what? I found what motivates me. The more no's I get, I know I'm closer to a yes.
Of course.
But it's plowing through all that rejection, which nobody likes, including me. But the reality is that's what we got. And if anything, we got to amp it up more, right?
Right. Yeah. But if you want to fail, just write down in your goals, failure. You got it. You're done.
Yeah. But let's not be scared of it. In a way, let's embrace, that's part of embracing the fear, acknowledging it, face it, confront it. And now let's plow through it. Is that what I'm hearing?
Yes.
Good.
It's easy to fail.
Good. Steve, you are just a wealth of information. I, out of respect for everybody attending today's session, I know we want to be respectful, and that is to bring some closure to today's program. How can they get more information, okay, to reach out and say, hey, this was great, and they got more questions, ideas? How can they get a hold of you?
Easy, obviously, website, steveschiffman.com, internet, sschiffman@steveschiffman.com. You just go Google me. You'll see the books. I mean, go and buy a book. Will you just go read something? Anything. Yeah. That doesn't have to be mine. Read something. So it's easy to get a hold of me. That's that. And then, you know, we do the coaching and we do the stuff. But the most important thing I want to leave with you is all of this is up to you. I want to give you a story, if you mind, Paul.
Please.
Story is about a young man who is studying with this great teacher. Absolutely great teacher. Kids maybe 9, 10 years old. And he has for the entire school year been thinking about what question can he ask the teacher that will stop the teacher cold. And he's been thinking about this a whole year, and he finally comes up with it. And what he does is he goes out and he gets a dove or a bird, and he holds the bird in his hand. Now, here's his premise. His premise is to go to the teacher and say, teacher, I have in my hand this dove, this bird. Is it alive or is it dead? Now, here's the problem. If the teacher says the bird is dead, he'll let it go. Yeah. If he says the bird is alive, he'll kill it. So there's no answer. There is no answer that the teacher can possibly give this young man except nothing. So he's so ready for this. So he goes up to the teacher, and you can picture it. You can picture the teacher sitting in the chair, looking down. The little boy comes and he says, "Teacher, I have in my hand this dove. Is it alive or is it dead?" Remember, he'll kill it if the teacher says it's alive. He'll let it go if the teacher says it's dead. So the teacher, without missing a beat, turns to the little boy and says, "The future of that dove is in your hands." And that's where you are today. Oh, you and I are in the same position. You. The future is in our hands.
Thank you. Thank you. That is inspiring, okay? It touches all of us to recognize that we have things in our control. I want to thank you, okay? I reflect back on how you've had an impact on my career starting out, and to reflect on the things that led to your success, my success, and so many lives that you've touched personally and professionally. Thank you, Steve, okay? It's been a pleasure to work with you today.
Paul, right? Thank you very much. You are it.
Welcome, everyone. Thank you, everyone, okay? Best to your success moving forward.